the older you get, the more you realize you don't know. And at the same time, the older you get, the more you realize you're running out of time to find out. And so when the older you get, I believe, the greater your sense of curiosity should be, mingled with a sense of urgency.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
John, I'm thinking of the folks listening who maybe are over 60, over 70, maybe have supported Focus on the Family for quite a while. We certainly appreciate you and what you have done. Today, we want to talk to two experts who are in their 80s. That's what makes them the experts, about aging. And they've written a book, Improving with Age. It's Stuart and Jill Briscoe. And this is a fabulous resource if you want to end well and please the Lord. And I know that's your heart. That's all of our hearts. Let's get off the grumpy trail and get on to a direction, a compass direction, that really honors the Lord right to the end. Mm-hmm. That's what we're going to talk about today, and I'm excited to get back to it. Welcome to both of you. Welcome back to Focus.
Thank you very much.
I so love the beginning of the discussion last time. We talked about your childhood situation being in England during World War II. In fact, Jill, you mentioned hearing Churchill's speech, one of his many wonderful speeches about courage. What caught your attention as a six-year-old girl when you heard Winston Churchill encourage the nation?
Fear. I couldn't help but hear the words over and over again. They're coming. We've nothing to stop them. That's what a six-year-old hears from that and knows that the church bells had to be quiet because that would be the signal for everyone in the world, in our world, to know the invasion had begun. That was our way of communicating with the entire nation.
What an amazing way to start your life.
And so what else but fear? And I think how that worked in my life, perhaps because of my personality, I'm very timid, and I'm frightened of everything. I always have been. I don't have courage until I realized what is courage. Courage is being obedient when you don't feel like it. Courage is doing the right things frightened out of your mind. Courage is going into a place that is a very difficult and dangerous place because that's where you should go. Mm. And I found that the power to be obedient happens. The power that I need isn't a feeling.
Right.
It's a decision. Courage is a decision. I'll go in if I must, frightened out of my mind.
Right.
Because it's the right thing to do.
That is so beautifully said. I was at a one of my boys' Bible studies. It was Troy, and he was probably 8 or 9 at the time. And I have a coffee cup that's John Wayne. This, we're going to put it in the American vernacular. And at this Bible study, the Bible study leader said, can any of you define the word courage? And Troy threw his hand up. And he said, yes, Troy. He said, courage is being scared to death, but saddling up anyway.
Absolutely.
And the man said, where did you hear that? He goes, my dad's John Wayne coffee cup. But that's really it.
That's
being
exactly
scared to death, but saddling up anyway.
Knowing you have to say that.
That is the Christian life.
Whatever the result of you saying something in a hostile situation, it needs to be said. And if you wait for, I love this feeling inside you, a sort of oomph. What is courage? We think it's a feeling. It is not.
What does courage look like in your 80s? And you've served the Lord so well over the years. You've been pastoring for many, many years. You've done marriage classes and still do them. Premarital counseling and all kinds of things. You've lived in the United States for 47 years. What does courage look like in your 80s when you know father time is right around the corner? You don't know what day it will happen that you'll step from this life into eternity. Well, what does courage look like?
I often quote the well-known theologian Woody Allen, who said, I'm not afraid of death. I just don't want to be there when it happens. Because it's different between death and dying. The Christian should have no fear of death. but the actual business of dying can be really fearsome.
Yeah.
It can be appalling. My only sibling died just a month or two ago. He's 4 years younger than me, and he battled lung cancer.
Mm.
He never smoked in his life,
mm.
but he had inflicted with that, and so there's plenty of things to fear there, but you don't allow it to paralyze you. You say, well, this is life. And you even goes, if you think carefully about it, you say that I am simply living in the curse of sin in this world.
Mm.
That God says you rebel against me, mm. and you will die, and it happens, and it's ugly and it's nasty.
Mm.
From the dying point of view, so you need a lot of courage to face up to that. And there are a lot of wonderful people, I'm sure, listening to this program who are bedfast.
Mm.
They don't have very much to look forward to, but they're lying there in their beds with quiet courage.
Yes.
They're dealing with their pain, not just physical pain, emotional pain. Their children are too busy to have much time, mm-hmm. for them. The grandchildren, they look at the grandchildren, they say, how in the world could we raise kids who have tattoos? This bothers them. And yet they want to be grandparently. They saddle up again.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, they saddle up.
And I think that's the kind of courage that we're talking about.
Absolutely. In fact, Jill, you had some health challenges and you were in the mm-hmm. hospital. How did you process that spiritually, intellectually,
yeah.
and what did God do in that moment?
Well, because I was converted in hospital through a nurse, all my trips into hospital in my life have been colored by mm. that. And the girl that led me to the Lord said, the mission field's between your own two feet at any given time, Jill. I said, what are you talking about? I'd never heard of a mission field, never mind
right.
what you're talking. She said, you'll find out. Here's the head nurse. Tell her what just happened. And seven nurses that first day she pushed me into. So I got it. And she said, hospital is always a prime place. People are frightened. She'd frightened me out of my mind. She said, I've been praying that you won't get well for a bit. I said, well, thanks. She said, I've got a lot to tell you.
Wow.
And I've heard your language. I've seen your friends. I've got to make use of all the time I have because I know what you're going back to at college.
Boy, that must have gotten your attention.
It got my attention. I said, when are you going to start and pray I get better? She said, that's my business. It's what I needed.
Yeah.
And so she taught me what it was all about, basically. So my trips into hospital, including last year at Christmas Eve with an obstruction and rushed into hospital, have always been with a spiritual anticipation of I'm going in for a Jill Ryder.
Yeah, it's like God meets you in that moment.
Oh, I get excited. And it was wonderful. I recommend going in over Christmas to any of you if you have a choice, because they let everybody go home they can. There's 20 doctors with nothing to do hanging around. It was wonderful. And I got even a note on my door after 4 days there. I need to talk to you. No name. Mm. It was one of the nurses. And it just gives you such an incredible opportunity.
Stuart, you mentioned in your book, Improving with Age, that you were an avid jogger. Now, I don't know why you would do that, but you love to jog, obviously. But there came a moment when you said, what am I doing? Describe that.
Well, yes, I was. I played rugby in my foolish youth. And then I went into the Marines. I served in the commandos, and so physical fitness was always something I was interested in, and so I tried to maintain it. And of course, traveling around the world as we do and have always done, it didn't matter where I was or in the world, you could always go out and run, and so I I did that for years and years. And one day, I caught a glimpse of myself in a store window that I was running past, and I thought, that looks like an old man stumbling.
Oh.
And so then I thought, why am I still doing this? How long have I been doing this? How many shoes have I worn out on this thing? How many thousands of miles have I run? I had no answer to any of those questions. I thought, I'm hot, I'm tired, I'm sticky, I'm aching, I'm having no fun at all. So I'll walk home. So I walked home.
You didn't run.
And on the way home, I heard the birds singing. And I walked past a lilac bush that I'd walked past dozens of times, run past dozens of times before, never smelt it before.
Mm.
And I realized that I had been focusing on one aspect of my life, blinkered, as far as many other aspects of my life were concerned. And so it was a case of realizing, you know, your days of running are gone. Mm-hmm. Forget it. That's gone. But your days of walking are beginning. And your days of walking at a slower pace are the beginning of observation that you've been too busy to note before.
Well, let me dig into that a bit, because I think there's something beautiful in that. Mm-hmm. God seems to be about simplicity. Mm-hmm. And so many of our years, especially our early years, are about complexity.
Yes.
You know, we're getting our careers going, we're raising young children, we're then raising teenagers. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, you're really going at light speed, it feels like. Mm-hmm. What have you learned in your 80-something years where the Lord is speaking in that whisper? It's not a lightning bolt. And you need to slow down and listen. That's a beautiful analogy. Practically, how have you heard the Lord in your 70s and 80s?
I talk about contemplation. I talk about meditation. I talk about reading. I've always been an activist. I think, actually, I probably suffer from ADHD, but they didn't know what they called it when I was doing it. And so even when I'm studying, I can sit still studying for about 20 minutes. That's my limit. I've got to get up and do something. I just don't keep up the same pace now. But I've embraced that. Mm-hmm. And I've realized that that gives me opportunities to do, as I said earlier, to be what I've never been and do what I've never done. Reading. I've taken on much bigger reading projects now, and I find my mind is expanding.
How do you keep that appetite, though? How do you really do that? So many people want to slow down.
My grandsons said to me one day, or some of the grandsons said to me one day, You have your nose in a book a lot of the time, Papa. I said, that's true. They said, why? And I said, because the older you get, the more you realize you don't know. And at the same time, the older you get, the more you realize you're running out of time to find out. Mm-hmm. And so when the older you get, I believe, the greater your sense of curiosity should be, mingled with a sense of urgency.
Let's talk about grandparenting. Yeah. I'm not there yet. You're not there yet,
not
John.
Not that I know of.
And
yeah.
So we can learn right here, right now, about the role of grandparenting. How is it different today because of modernity and the pace of life, the way that families locate around the globe or around a country, mm-hmm. like here in the U.S.? Grandparents may have great distances mm-hmm. and don't get to see their grandchildren that often.
Sure.
What are some ideas to stay engaged in a grandchild's life, and what's the importance of it?
If you become a grandparent at 50, there's a very real possibility you're going to be a grandparent for 35 or 40 or even more years. Mm-hmm. Think about that. That is a role that you fulfill for 35 or 40 years.
And you can have tremendous impact.
Well, of course you can.
Jill, let me ask you this. You described yourself as a bit timid in the old days, at least. It sounds like the Lord is still giving you courage to talk to people.
I'll be timid till I see Jesus.
Well, in that context, being a grandparent can be intimidating because you don't know how to always respond, how to engage. And teenagers and 20-somethings can be intimidating to grandparents because they may not have the same values. They may not agree on certain worldview issues. How do you stay courageous as a grandparent with your grandchildren who might be a bit more difficult?
Well, I tell you, it's prayer, not for them, with them.
Hmm.
And you've got to get your grandkids scared to death of your prayers, whoever you are, grandma and grandpa. Let me give you an illustration. If they know your prayers work, they're going to be scared of you praying for them, okay? I realized this very early on, in a good sense, that they've got to be scared. And I remember when some of them, they were all in their teenage years, and we have a lot of celebrations and bands down at Summerfest. And our eldest grandchild, who was 17, I said to him one day, "What are you doing tonight, Danny?" And he says, "Oh, we're going to hear the band at Summerfest." I said, "Which one?" And he told me, and I said, "Danny, that's not a good idea." "Oh, it's all right. We're all the group from church, Nana. We're all going together, Nana." I said, "It's not a good idea. Look at me, Danny. Why don't you wait? There's a country western coming in 3 weeks. That would be fine. We'll come with you to that." No, we're going." I said, "You're going to do it, aren't you?" He said, "Yes." I said, "Okay, Danny, I'm going to pray for you." He said, "Don't." Scared to death of my prayers. And as it happened, and this is funny in a way, he got sick. I said, when I heard this, I thought, "Oh, my word." So he calls me.
It wasn't what you prayed.
He calls me. He said, "Nana, I got sick." I said, "Danny, I promise you I didn't pray you'd get sick." Now we laugh about it. He's the one that's 30.
Yeah.
He's had a long spiritual journey. He came back and he loves God. He's out and out now. And not long ago, he said, "Nana, we became absolutely intent on you praying for us because we knew your prayers worked and you shared it with us. And then when you went away, you said, let's meet in the throne room on a Monday, wherever we are in the world. All of us on a Monday, wherever Monday is, in eternity is the same." And so we did, all the grandkids growing up, we all prayed for each other on a Monday, wherever we were, we met in the throne room. And I just tried to show them how, why would it not make a difference if we're all together beneath the praise of angels,
amen,
talking with God, right? And that's just one aspect of grandparenting, and we can all do that.
Yeah, it's beautiful, beautiful story.
And as we're talking about the kinds of ministries you can have with your grandchildren, broaden that out just a little bit to churches. You've said that you have a really dynamic church. I imagine there are a lot of folks in their senior years who aren't plugged in, who either they don't feel invited or they don't feel equipped.
Yeah.
How can they get started? What do you say to them?
I think we've got a real problem in the church with generationalism, but that's what we've done, and we've divided up our churches into peer groups, and we have to find ways of intentionally bringing the peer groups together. Jill came across something recently where she saw older people and young people sitting together, and the younger people were teaching the older people their computers. But it was they were doing this in the Sunday school hour, but then including in that computer teaching time of the young ones teaching the older ones, that they were then bringing in some cross-generational teaching.
Neat idea.
Yeah, that's a great idea.
The basic thing we've got to do if we're going to have any influence on our young people is be interested in what they're interested in.
Yeah.
And that's going to take a conscious effort at times, but just be interested in what they're interested in. And that takes time. But one of the things I do now is I have a Popper's Monthly Roundup, and I write to all my grandkids once a month, and I ask them all to write back to me with a statement of their beings and doings of the last month. And that is very interesting. They don't always write back, They don't always write back on time. You've got to corral them. But they are all unanimous in saying, don't stop it, Papa.
Yeah.
We need this. So Papa's monthly roundup has been part of their lives for a long time.
That is beautiful. We're wrapping up right here at the end. And Jill, I did want to end with this question, which I think will help many. Was there ever a time that you lacked the sense that you could be useful for the Lord's service in this whole journey? Did you ever have doubts about where you could fit in your 70s and now in your 80s?
No, it's coming right back to that 3 weeks in hospital when that's my seminary. I've never had a chance to go.
Yes.
But it's just being who God wants you to be wherever you do.
Yeah.
I had a wonderful talk with somebody behind the airline counter coming to this 3 weeks ministry. I don't care if I did anything else because of the wonderful time I had with that lady that took my ticket on the airport.
So you're looking for that opportunity always.
I'm expecting it.
Yeah, expecting it.
I'm not, I don't have to look. Yeah. Why would God, who's so short of workers, not use you every time you go out the door?
Yeah.
I had a fabulous time in the checkout counter in the grocery store the other day. And then I spoke to a big meeting at night, asked me what was my highlight. It was that encounter by the cornflakes.
What keeps us from expecting it, though? Because it doesn't come naturally.
Because raise up your eyes and look at the harvest. They're white. And pray that the Lord of the harvest will thrust out workers. It's ready. And he's talking to the disciples who've brought lunch back. And get your eyes off your lunch. What's he saying? He's looking at the harvest, you know, all the people coming up the hill.
Yes.
And they've just been to get lunch.
Well, your resource, which is a wonderful resource, Improving with Age, Stuart and Jill Briscoe, the authors, our guests today and last time. You've done a wonderful job putting this together. And I'm telling you, if you're an adult child, maybe in your 50s, and you have parents who need to read this, get it for them as a gift, and vice versa. I mean, if you're that 70, 80-something, and you're saying, Lord, what do you have that I can do to feel productive?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
This is a tool that you can dive into, and there are many, many examples, and we've only really scratched the surface here in our 2 days with the Briscoes. But this is something that you can do. And I believe you can open your eyes to that harvest that Jill was just mentioning and be even more productive in the latter years of your life than you were in your 20s and 30s and 40s.
Sure.
So take the challenge. End well. And it has been so good to talk to both of you. Thanks for being with us.
Well, thank you.
Thank you. Pleasure.
And by the way, we feel so strongly about the Briscoes book and getting it into your hands. Make a generous donation of any amount today to the work here at Focus on the Family, and we'll send a copy to you. It's our way of saying thank you for investing in what we do here to reach families just across the spectrum, from pre-married to seniors. We care, and you're part of the ministry when you donate. And on behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team, thanks for listening. I'm John Fuller, hoping you'll join us again next time as we once again help you and your family thrive.